Hello everyone, welcome to new IAS daily current affairs program. Today is 12th of January 2019 and the news we will be covering today are economic cycle, bioavailability, bioaccessibility and bioactivity in nutrition, Gaganyaan and Chandrayaan 2 updates, Raman spectroscopy. For the map session, we will be dealing with Murshidabad and last we have PQRS. So, coming to the very first topic about economic cycle. So, the stock markets have performed badly in 2018 with a fear of recession looming after the second longest economic expansion in the United States, which began after the 2008 recession in accordance with the economic cycle. Alright, so this is an economic cycle or it is a continuous process where you will see growth, boom, recession in a cycle. So, economic cycle or a business cycle is a natural fluctuation in the economy between the periods of expansion or growth and contraction or recession. So, it is a cycle of growth and recession. Factors such as gross domestic product, interest rates, levels of employment, consumer spending, all these can help determine the current stage of economic cycle. So, during the time of expansion, investors seek to purchase companies in technology, capital goods and basic energy. And during the time of contraction, investors look to purchase companies such as utilities, financials and healthcare. Alright? Talking about the stages of economic cycle, there are four stages in an economic cycle, that is expansion, peak, contraction and trough. Okay, so expansion is a stage where the economy experiences relatively rapid growth, interest rates tend to be low, then production increases and inflationary pressures build up. Peak is a stage where growth hits its maximum output and it creates some imbalances in the country. Whereas contraction, it is where the growth slows and employment falls and the prices stagnate. And trough is a stage where the economy hits a low point in growth from which recovery can begin again. Okay, so it is a four-stage cycle. How the economic cycle is managed? The government and the RBI have role in it. The government uses its fiscal policy while the central bank uses its monetary policy to help manage and control the economic cycle. An expansionary policy is used to end or recover from a recession. Expansionary policy is used to recover from a recession while a contractionary policy would help to prevent the economy from peaking or running away to inflation. Okay, expansionary policy and contractionary policy. I hope you are clear with this topic. Coming to the next topic, that is about bioavailability, bioaccessibility and bioactivity in nutrition. So, you might be familiar with many terms like bioremediation, bioaccumulation. So, there are so many terms starting with bio, right? So, this is a new term. This was in news because recently the Karnataka government's midday meal scheme ran into controversy as one of its NGO partners, that is Akshaya Patra Foundation, they refused to include onion and garlic in the meal. Both onion and garlic were found to enhance the bioaccessibility of iron and zinc from grains. Alright, so what is this bioavailability? Bioavailability can be defined as the proportion of the food capable of being absorbed and which is available for use or storage. That is, it refers to the proportion of a nutrient that is absorbed from a diet and it is used for the normal body functions. Okay, and it is governed by external and internal factors. The external refers to the food matrix and the chemical form of the nutrient in question. And the internal will be gender, age, nutrient status and life stage. Alright, so bioavailability of macronutrients such as carbohydrates, proteins and fats is usually high at more than 90% of the amount ingested. On the other hand, micronutrients, that is vitamins, minerals and bioactive phytochemicals, can vary widely in the extent and they can be absorbed and utilized. So bioavailability includes gastrointestinal digestion, absorption, metabolism, tissue distribution and bioactivity. Now, what is this bioaccessibility? It is defined as the quantity of a compound that is released from its matrix in the gastrointestinal tract becoming available for absorption. So it is nothing but the quantity of a compound that is released to the intestinal tract and it is available for absorption. So this includes digestive transformation of food into material which is ready for absorption. Okay. And talking about bioactivity, it is the specific effect upon exposure to a substance. So it includes the tissue uptake and the consequent physiological response. Examples are antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, etc. So it includes the tissue uptake and the consequent physiological responses. It also includes information on how the bioactive compounds are transported and how they reach the targeted tissues, how they interact with the biomolecules, then the metabolism and the biotransformation characteristics. All these information are included in bioactivity. Alright, now coming to Gaganyaan and Chandrayaan 2 updates. So ISRO announced setting up of Human Space Flight Center for the Gaganyaan project, while Chandrayaan 2, the second moon mission, will be delayed to April end. And Gaganyaan is an Indian crewed orbital spacecraft which is intended to be the basis of Indian human space flight program. It is an Indian human space flight program. So if India does launch the Gaganyaan mission, it will be the fourth nation to do so after United States, Russia and China. Alright, and ISRO conducted its first pad abort test successfully. What is this pad abort test? So pad abort test or crew escape system, it is an emergency escape measure that helps pull the crew away from the launch vehicle when a mission has to be aborted. Okay, it is an emergency escape measure which will help to pull out the crew members away when the mission has to be aborted. Alright, that is pad abort test. And this is planned to be launched on ISRO's GSLV MK3 in 2022. Now talking about Chandrayaan 2, so it is India's second mission to the moon, which is totally indigenous mission comprising the orbiter, lander and rover. So after reaching the 100 kilometer lunar orbit, the lander housing the rover will separate from the orbiter. The lander and the rover will be separated from the orbiter, and after a controlled descent, the lander will have a soft land on the lunar surface at a specified site and it will and deploy the rover. The payloads will collect information about the lunar topography, then about the minerals, that is mineralogy, elemental abundance, then lunar exosphere and the presence of water, everything. Alright, and this figure shows the journey, Chandrayaan 2 mission to moon. So as I explained, the GSLV MK2 will carry Chandrayaan 2 and It will be launched from Sriharikota, and the spacecraft will carry an orbiter, rover and lander. And once the GSLV MK2 reaches the geostationary transfer orbit, it will put the spacecraft into an elliptical orbit. And then what happens? The orbiter will reach moon's orbit in over a month. And once the orbiter reaches the moon, the lander will get detached from the orbiter and do a soft launch. And then a six-wheel rover fixed within the lander will get detached over the lunar surface. That is the total path of the Chandrayaan mission. Now we have a topic from science and technology, that is Raman spectroscopy. So the researchers of Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, they have found an innovative way to detect mercury contamination in water using the Raman spectroscopy. So what is this technique? It is a sensor that operates using the surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. A volamphiphile molecule abbreviated as HPH. It was used to bind the mercury contamination in water sample and then it is subjected to Raman spectroscopy. I will explain you what is Raman spectroscopy. Before that, this method enhances sensitivity to as high as 0.01 parts per quadrillion compared to 0.1 parts per billion when a solution of HPH in the water sample is subjected to Raman spectroscopy. So, note that a volamphiphile is a molecule which has a hydrophilic and a hydrophobic groups. Talking about Raman spectroscopy, it is one of the vibrational spectroscopic techniques which is used to provide information on molecular vibrations and crystal structures. And this technique will use a laser light source to irradiate a sample and it will generate an infinitesimal amount of Raman scattered light, which is detected as Raman spectrum. Talking about Raman effect, when light is scattered by matter, almost all the scattering is an elastic process and there is no change in energy. However, a very small percentage of scattering is an inelastic process. Thus, a scattered light has different energy from the incident light. That's about the topic. And coming to map aided program, today we will be seeing Murshidabad. And Murshidabad and the Futi Masjid was covered in the newspaper. We will talk about Futi Masjid, and it is a large unfinished mosque said to be built during the reign of Sarfaraz Khan. It has four cupolas at the corners and only two of its planned rooms were completed as the builder died soon after the construction began. Okay, so Futi Masjid means broken mosque. And talking about Murshidabad, it is a town in West Bengal. It is located to the eastern bank of the Hooghly River. Murshidabad was founded by Murshid Quli Khan, who was the Diwan of Bengal and later the Nawab of Bengal. Alright, and the city has many buildings including the Katra Masjid, Hazardwari Palace, etc. Coming to PQRS, that is previous year question revision series. With reference to fly ash produced by the power plants using coal as fuel, which of the following statements is or are correct? First statement is, fly ash can be used in the production of bricks and building construction. Two, fly ash can be used as a replacement for some of the Portland cement concrete. Three, fly ash is made up of silicon dioxide and calcium oxide only and does not contain any toxic elements. These are the options and it's really a very simple question. You can easily eliminate. Read the third statement. They say that fly ash is only made up of silicon dioxide and calcium oxide and does not contain any toxic elements. Is that correct? No, right? Because whenever you study about pollutants, you will obviously study about fly ash and its consequence. It is hazardous, it is toxic. So that statement is wrong, and the right answer to question is option A, that is 1 and 2. The statements 1 and 2 are correct. So what is fly ash? Fly ash or the flue ash is a coal combustion product that is composed of particulates, that is fine particles of burned fuel that are driven out of coal-fired boilers together with the flue gases. So fly ash is a building material specifically used for the masonry, and it contains class C fly ash and water. All fly ash includes substantial amount of silicon dioxide, aluminium oxide and calcium oxide. The main mineral compounds in coal breaking rock strata. Okay, that is fly ash. Fly ash can be used as a replacement for some of the cement contents of concrete. So the options 1 and 2 are correct, and the third statement is wrong. Okay, it is a pollutant. So with that, we wind up today's session. You can download the daily current affairs material from the description given below. Thank you for watching.